So welcome to week number 7 of our Healing Choices series. And in this series, what we've been doing, we usually don't do series this long, but this is a set of 8. And what we've been doing is giving you choices that help you, if you'll make the choice, to move past your hurts, habits, and hangups. And here's what happens for many of us. How many of you ever been hurt? We've all been hurt, we've all been wounded, we've all been through some things. And then what begins to happen is out of that hurt, because we're not really healed of it, we haven't let God do what he wants to do, in the middle of that, we end up developing some habits, and then we kind of get stuck, we get hung up on some things in our life, and it's just difficult to move forward. And so what we've been helping you do in this series is just helping you to move forward past that. And so before we get into the message, though, this morning, I want to tell you where we're headed in the next month or so. So next week, we're going to wrap up this series. And then beginning in November, I'm beginning a series we're calling Dilemma. You know, we live in a world that looks very different from what we see in the Bible. Actually, if you go to the Old Testament, it looks a lot like what's in the Bible. But just because God reports it doesn't mean he condones it. Just remember that. But we're gonna do a series that help us not only love well, but stand strong in this season. And so God's got a both and he wants us to do. We're going to lean into that in the month of November. And so let's just set your heart to come and to be a part of that. I think it'll help you in a lot of those personal situations, a lot of those conversations that you end up having with neighbors, friends, coworkers, and that kind of thing. You'll just be a better place for it. So let's begin with a question today. What if you had to be the exact same person that you are today for the rest of your life? That'd be pretty tough, wouldn't it? That'd be a pretty hard thing. Never learned anything new. Got the same issues for the rest of your life. Just, you know, kids exactly the same, you know, perfect as they are now, as imperfect as they are. Just, wouldn't that be a strange, it really sounds terrible, doesn't it? Because we all have hope for better. And so today's message in this series is really about moving forward. So we've dealt with some challenging topics and areas in this series. And the reason we do that is we believe that God wants all of us to grow spiritually. He wants us to develop. He wants us to move, get healed, move past things, make changes, make adjustments in our lives. And so our desire should be that we're going to cooperate with God as we continue growing and developing into the people that he wants us to be. And so really, you can stay the same. And by the way, many people do. They just simply choose that. I'm not going there. You've heard this. That's just the way I am. So we get to decide if we're going to grow, we're going to move forward, if we're going to take the next steps that God desires for us to take, so that we can only not become the people he wants us to be, but we can live the way he wants us to live. And so today's focus is about moving past the hurts, habits, and hangups of life, moving to what? Finishing the race. Moving to getting up when you've been knocked down. Moving to growing and being more like Jesus every single day. And here's the thing, you know, I know, life is not a sprint. Life is a marathon. You just got to keep slogging. You got to keep going. It's difficult, but you got to keep doing it. And so if you've been attending and applying this series to your life, you've grown. I know you've grown. But here's what the word says in 2 John verse 8. There's only one chapter, so if you like 1:8, you can use that, or 2 John 8, however you want to do it. Watch out that you do not lose what you have worked so hard to achieve. Be diligent so that you receive your full reward. So this message today is about how not to lose ground, how not to work, not to lose what you've allowed God to do and the work you've allowed him to do in your life so far. So I mean, let's not work hard, flame out, and finish poorly. Let's finish well. Amen. Don't you want to hear the Lord say, "Well done, good and faithful servant"? So in this life, it's a marathon. It's not how you start; it's how you finish. And probably every one of us have things about our start that we don't like. And there's some things that have happened along the way that are not real good. And I just want to tell you, all of that is part of your story, but it doesn't have to be your entire future. God has a future and a hope for you. And so I want us to finish well, but some people don't. They just simply flame out. So I'd like to give you a few reasons that people flame out. You ready? You ready to go? Here's the first one. They blame God. Why? Well, something happens and we just can't seem to get past it. A marriage ends. Well, there's an unexpected death. There's an unanswered question. There's a tragedy. There's a struggle that, you know, I remember saying this a number of years ago. One of the most depressing times in your life is when you get to a certain age. It doesn't matter what the age it is. And you say, I thought by now I'd be past this. And we get some of those things going on in our lives and we're just like, you know, God, why? Why am I stuck? And so what we do is we get stuck and instead of turning to God, we blame God and we turn away from Him. Not because we're horrible people. It's because we cannot see how to grow past our hurts, habits, and hang-ups. We just can't see. I don't know how to get past this. See, stuff happens in life. Bad stuff happens in life. Really bad stuff happens in life. Stuff we don't understand. And so what happens is we get stuck. And so sometimes we have this misconception that God's sovereignty means that He is controlling everything that happens. I want to just help you this morning with that because the Bible tells us that He does know the number of hairs on your head. So He knows about the smallest part of your life. But He also gives you the freedom. Come on, ladies, you know what I'm talking about here. He also gives you the freedom when that first gray hair shows up. You pluck it. It's gone. So he knows all about it. So God gives us freedom within this world that He's created. And so we've got to understand that. Blaming God for the choices of others, blaming God for the failures within ourselves, blaming God for the attacks of the enemy, all they serve to do is harden our heart, keep us from moving forward. Another thing that will cause us to flame out is when we remain offended. Now, this could be a whole series, but I'm just giving you the condensed version here this morning. So Jesus said that we're all going to get offended. He said, praise the Lord, because it's been a lot lately. The key here is not to stay offended. Amen. Not to stay offended. So right now, what year is it? It's election year. Yeah. Yeah. Some of you, you're offended at the opposite political party. And it doesn't matter which side you're for. You're offended at the other one. Because they're just wrong. How many know they're wrong? And so what the devil does in the middle of that is he gets us to stop praying for our leaders. We're so busy worried about what the other side is doing wrong that we stop praying for the leaders. Even, by the way, you're supposed to pray for the leaders whether you agree with them or not. Right? Maybe you pray more when you disagree with them. And God's going, now we get to talk. You know, He thinks different than we think. So some of you are so offended at the opposite political party that your friends are affiliating with, it's beginning to strain your relationships. For some of you, it may have ended some relationships. There is offense working. Here's what Matthew 13, 57 says, verse 57 and 58. And they were deeply offended and refused to believe in Him. That's Jesus. And look at this. Basically what was going on in this story, you should read it for yourself, but Jesus came into this town and it was his hometown. And they all said, oh, we know who this is. This is the carpenter's son. We know his mother. We know his siblings. And then it says this verse, and they were deeply offended and refused to believe in Him. And look at this last verse. And so He did only a few miracles there because of their unbelief. I want to just help you with something right here because it's a big deal. When you're offended at somebody else, you think you're hurting them. But what it does, according to this, it stops God from working in your life. Amen. Amen. So you can get stuck. You can flame out when you're offended at everybody else. They cut me off. They didn't vote the way I did. They don't like what I like. I mean, we're just talking your household here. We haven't even got outside the household yet. I mean, you can all have all that, right? You've seen it. You get hurt. You blame God. You get offended at the person. You hold on to it. And what happens is a once vibrant, growing person shuts down and you get stuck. You don't move forward. We got to forgive people. Everyone say forgive. That was last week's message. If you missed it, go to our website and get it. But we got to forgive to be able to move forward. Here's another thing that will help cause us to flame out. When we just stop growing. We just stop growing. In the Old Testament, God provided what they called manna. Remember that? God provided manna for 40 years. 40 years in the wilderness. They weren't planting crops, harvesting crops. They weren't, you know, getting all that kind of stuff. He provided manna for 40 years in the wilderness. But he provided it, listen, daily. Everyone say daily. So they picked it up every day. And you know when God got really ticked? Is because of their fear that there would not be any the next day, they disobeyed his command and took extra for them on the first day, and the result was it rotted and spoiled. I think the Bible says it had maggots in it. Ugh. So here's what I want to tell you today. Growth is like manna. You can't live off yesterday's growth, and you can't live off yesterday's manna. He provided on his specific command, he said, on Friday essentially, gather a double portion so you don't have to go out and gather it on the Sabbath. There's going to be seasons that you may coast a little bit on some previous growth, and it's a God-ordained thing. But generally, you've got to be thinking, what is God trying to do fresh and new on the inside of me today so that I can keep growing and keep developing and really keep moving with him? So if you decide this is who I'm going to be for the rest of my life, you're going to flame out. There's no such thing in God as just staying the same. You're either increasing in your walk with God or you're decreasing. I mean, there's just no other choice. You cannot hold it because sustaining will result in decline. You just got to understand it's so important to grow. And so today's choice is the growth choice. Here it is. I reserve a daily time with God for Bible reading, self-examination, and prayer in order to know God and His will for my life and to gain the power to follow His will. So you've got to understand spiritual growth is a choice. You don't accidentally spiritually grow. You've got to be intentional. You've got to decide. And you all know this. Getting older doesn't make you more mature. Because I found there's a certain age you come and you just start saying whatever you want and it reveals what you haven't learned. I'm trying not to let that happen to me, all right? So we got to choose, though. I'm going to overcome in this area. Right? I'm gonna press in. I'm going to get past my past. I'm going to choose some new behaviors. I'm going to lean into some new ways of growing because I'm determined to grow. We've got to choose to grow. We don't have to, but I want to tell you it's the best choice to choose to grow. Actually, you want to know what God's will for your life is? Continually growing in God. That's His will. Here's what 2 Peter 3:18 says. Rather, you must grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus, of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So, it's not just knowledge, it's becoming more like. It's letting that knowledge produce something in our lives. And so, hopefully this series has ignited some forward momentum in your life, but let's talk about how we keep it going today, and that's the growth choice. Here's the first thought. Set a daily time with God. A daily time with God. Now, some of you say, well, I do this or I know this. Don't check out. Because I want you to lean into this with me today. See, our daily time with God is how we get to know God. It's also how we get to tell God what we know about ourselves. He already knows, but He wants you to know what He knows about you. Right? So it's how we connect to God in our tough times and we share that experience with Him. It's how in those great times we celebrate with God and we say thank you and we say praise you, God, Lord. And we just have this moment with God where we're giving Him honor and glory. It's in that daily time. What's it about? It's about connection. What's the biggest challenge of 2020 for most people? Connection. It's been difficult to get together and to be in places and spaces that you want to be with people. And it's the same thing in our time with God. We're not going to grow unless we remain connected to Jesus. It's vital. Here's what John 15 says. I love this passage. It's a little longer, about four verses, but just stick with me in here. It says, remain in me, Jesus says, and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it's severed from the vine. Doesn't matter who does the severing. Okay, and you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. Yes, I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce what? Much fruit. So if you don't see your life producing the fruit you want it to produce, you need to go back and look at the connection. Fruit always produces based on what it's connected to. If you don't know who you're connected to, look at what your life is producing. If your life, it's Matthew 12. You can look that up there. That's how you tell a tree. Years ago, this isn't the point of the message, but I'm going to tell you this one anyway. Years ago, I was working in the business world, and I did an evaluation for an employee, and my boss was a Christian, and he said Doug, he said, so what's the fruit of this person's life? I was like, we're at work. What are you asking me that kind of stuff for right here? Because I'd read, you know, how many of you hate writing reviews and evaluations? It's just a thing. You love the person, but it can be really tough to do that, right? And some of us are really polite. We don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. So I wrote a polite review. And he said, what's the fruit? And then we got honest. He said, the fruit wasn't what it should have been, right? So I had to change my review, right? So you always wonder what some, just look at the fruit. You don't have to do anything else. Just look at the fruit in your life. He said, I'm the vine, you're the branches, those that remain in me, and I and them will produce much fruit. And if it's connected to Jesus, good fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Everyone say withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile to be burned. But if you remain in me and my words remain in you, both, you may ask for anything you want and it'll be granted. In other words, your prayer life will be fueled by your word life. When you produce much fruit, you are my true disciples. This brings great glory to my Father. Amen. So a daily time with God is how we stay connected to God. It's like a marriage. If your marriage is struggling, maybe you're not spending enough time together. Maybe the only time you're together is you're fussing and fighting and arguing. Right? You got to change that. So in our relationship with God, what's God doing? He's inviting us to spend time with Him. I don't know why I feel led to say this. And that doesn't mean just listening to worship music and watching Christian television. That's not your time with God. That's your time with worship music, and that's your time with Christian television. Turn all that stuff off and have some time. Just enjoy His presence. Now, you're going to have to fight for this time. It's going to be a fight. You're going to have to put aside good things to do the best things. You may need to get up early. Most of you know this, but my habit for 30 plus years has been to get up early in the morning because I had to figure out a time when my mind was not going 180 miles an hour. And the only time to do that is to get out of bed, roll out of bed in the morning, and get with Jesus. So my habit now, a few years ago during our 21 days of prayer and fasting, the Lord just convicted me. He said, I want you to read the Bible the first thing, because I would go walk and pray and then read my Bible over breakfast. So I don't even get out of bed right now. I got the Bible right on my phone. I just read my Bible reading plan before I even get out of bed. Get up, go walk and pray and spend time with Jesus. But you got to find what that time is for you. So he said, well, I'm going to do it at night. How often is that happening? I'm tired. This is happening. It's just always something. So you just got to decide it's going to be the morning. Amen? That's free for all you night owls. That was free. 1 John 3:6 says, anyone who continues to live in him will not sin. Victory over sin comes not out of all your knowledge. It comes from time with God. Time with God. See, the reason many people struggle in their walk with God and eventually fall away is they don't spend daily time with God. Again, daily. One-on-one. Just you. Your Bible. And the Holy Spirit right there working with you. Amen? I mean, and you say, man, I just struggle with this all the time. Well, here, I have an idea for you. You can go online right now. You can grab the notes. You can email them to yourself and take this outline and divide it up into the next 7 days and take 1/7 each day. Read those scriptures. Ask God how it applies to your life. I promise you, you'll have 5 minutes with Jesus that day. It's not difficult. And if you miss it, don't get condemned. Just get in the Word. Get with Jesus. Amen? Nothing will work in your Christian life for very long if you're not spending time with God. It's just not going to work. Here's the second thing we need to do. Fill your mind with Scripture. Amen. Fill your mind with Scripture. If you're going to finish the race, you got to have the right fuel. Right? You got to have the right fuel. So athletes, I mean, it's been the last 15, 20 years, a huge explosion in the emphasis on nutrition for high performance in athletes. So you're a spiritual athlete. Look at someone and say, you're a spiritual athlete. Come on, tell them. Yeah. And so you need some good nutrition, and your spiritual nutrition is the Word of God. Matthew 4:4, Jesus told him, that's the devil, no, the Scriptures say people do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. It's not just enough to come on Sunday and listen to a message once a week. I'm just telling you, I'm great. I mean, you know, you ain't going to say it, but I'll say it. No, I'm kidding. My pastor used to say, he that tooteth not his horn shall not be tooteth. But it's not enough. You need time with Jesus alone. It's like saying, you know what? I'm going to eat one meal this week. Let's talk on Thursday. It's going to be rough. It's going to be hard. Your Bible reading, your time in the Scripture, that's your spiritual fuel. Now, as a teenager, I was raised on a farm. Many of you know I'm a southern boy from southern Minnesota. I'm a farm kid, raised on the farm. But then when I was in high school, I raised sheep. I did a lot of things for those sheep. Fed them. You know, put all the food out for them, all kinds of things to make them do what they were supposed to do. But you know what? I never ate their food for them. I can bring you the food. I can set a platter. I can do all that. I can try to communicate in a way that's the best, but I can't eat it for you. Every sheep on their own has to eat and on their own, and the Bible calls us sheep, right? Amen? So we got to do that. So, you know, the other thing about the Word that's so powerful is imagine taking, I know this is, there's some things trending this way, but imagine only taking a shower once a week. Well, worse, imagine being around people who only take a shower once a week. I mean, that's yucky. Can I use y'all somebody's language? Yeah, yucky. It's now your language. It's yucky. We go through life and you don't have to try, but junk just comes on you. You can drive down the freeway and see a billboard and all of a sudden your mind is someplace it shouldn't be. You can flip through the television or go online and do, I mean, it's everywhere. So Ephesians 5:26, it's not in your notes. And it's not on the screen, but it says that we're cleansed with the washing of the Word. Amen. There's something about that daily time. It just cleanses you. So the Word provides what? Spiritual strength for the battles of life, wisdom for the dilemmas of life, and the power to win in life. You say, well, Pastor, I just don't have time. Then you're too busy. Actually, I'm going to meddle. Most of you are on social media. If you had time to be on social media, you had time to be with Jesus today. Amen. Amen. I'm just a pastor. I love you. If you had time to turn on the television, you had time to be with Jesus. If you had time to open up your browser on your phone or go to an app or text somebody, you had time to be with Jesus. it's not a, if anybody says they don't have time, it's not a, it's never a time issue. It's always a priority issue. And you just got to decide, I'm going to make it a priority. Now, it could be one other issue. It could be what I'm going to call a translation issue. I was raised on the King James translation. I love the King James. But you know, thou dost not speak that way much anymore. If that translation lights your fire, man, go for it. And please don't spare me all the emails about it's the only right translation. That's baloney anyway, and hopefully I didn't offend you. Because they're all translations from the original. Come on. Right? But get something like the New Living Translation. Get something like, even if you want something closer to King James, go English Standard Version. And one of the reasons I preach from the New Living Translation, for any of you that are wondering, is because one of the first things I learned as a pastor is most people aren't reading their Bibles. And I wanted them to read it. So I picked a translation. I shouldn't tell you all this. It's written on the seventh grade level. So even I can understand it. And it's written so it sounds like it's written like a story. What am I trying to do? I'm just trying to get you in the Word. Because it'll change your life. How many of you want to be happy? How many want to be really happy? James 1:25. But the truly happy people are those who carefully study God's perfect law that makes people free, and they continue to study it. They do not forget what they've heard, but they obey what God's teaching says. Those who do this will be made happy. And then when you not just do it once or twice, but you abide in it, here's what John 8:31 says. Then Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. It's not the truth that makes you free, it's the truth you know for your situation. That's what you get by abiding. So if we want to be transformed, if we want a new life, if we want victory over tormenting thoughts, it's really simple. We've got to get in the Word of God every day and apply it to our lives. Here's what Romans 12:2 says. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The way to transform your life is not outward. It always starts with your thought life. And God's thoughts are higher than our thoughts, but he gave them to us so that we can make them ours. Amen? You just got to do it every day. Repetition for life. So you say, well, I don't know how to get started. Most of you have a smartphone. Just go on there, download the Bible app, and you can find a Bible reading plan on about all kinds of subjects. It'll even remind you. And if you, those of you that have goals, it'll even tell you your streak. I'm on a streak of 60-some weeks, I think, using the app. I've read it other times outside the app. But it's just a fun little way to do it. Whatever it takes. You can go to our website. We've got a chronological Bible reading plan out there if you want to read it in the order it happened, not the order it's laid out in the Bible. You can go there. You can learn that. It's a good thing to do. Get in the Word. Amen? Amen. And when you miss it, get up and do it again. Here's number three. Focus on my goal, not my habit. I got to move quick now. Focus on my goal, not my habit. When I say habit, I'm referring to those hurts, habits, hang-ups, sins, weaknesses, failures, all those things. You can focus on them, right? But when you focus on what you shouldn't do, it's a problem. It's like deciding you're not going to eat the, in my case, dark chocolate covered almonds that are on the counter right now in a big bowl like that. And I just want to say I got those last Sunday and they're not all gone. So I've done good, right? But I've walked by many times saying I'm not going to eat as many today as I did yesterday, but I see them. And the more I focus on not eating them, the more they're there. They scream. Do you know they scream? The things that you get hung up on, they scream at you too. Here's what Philippians 3:14. By the way, that's why diets usually don't work to lose weight, because we're focused on the wrong thing. We're focused on the food instead of the health. Philippians 3:13. No, dear brothers and sisters, I have not achieved it, but I focus on this one thing, forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead. Forgetting the past, looking forward to what lies ahead. I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us. So God has created us to go towards whatever we focus on. You ever taught a young new driver how to drive a car? Where, you know, that you just kind of taking your life in your own hands. You don't trust them to do the dishes right. Now you're going to give them the keys to a car. Come on, right? Anybody know what I'm talking about? And you get in that car, and you know what? If they're not careful, you got to teach them to spend more time looking out of the windshield than they're looking out of the rearview mirror or the side mirrors. Those are important. Of course, when Kim's mom trained Kim, she went and Kim got her license. She wouldn't let Kim look at the mirrors. That's one way to do it, I guess. Kay would say, all right, it's safe to go. It's safe to go. That's how Kim learned. So now Kim assumes that I'm not watching anything. And we can be driving, and when Kim's in the car, I don't have to watch everything. Because she is. And so all of a sudden, I'll hear a... And the more intense it is, there's no words that come out, but all it means is something bad is about to happen. You need to pay attention. And it's up to me to figure it out. The whole point of all this, I digressed, is to focus on the windshield. And there's a reason it's bigger than your rearview mirror too. You're supposed to be focusing forward. So here, let me tell you this. It's time to get your focus off your past. Yes, you need to get it dealt with. Yes, you need to heal from it. All of those things. But we've got to focus on the direction that we're heading. Your past is not who you are. You are who God says you are. It influences you, but it does not have to define you. What matters today is not your past. It's your future. Where are you choosing to head right now? You say, well, I'm trying to make some changes. Well, how about if you've got a habit you're trying to break, how about focusing on the amount of money you could be saving? That'll help you. Instead of saying I'm trying to break the habit, think, man, I could put $50 a month in my savings account or whatever, or I could buy this or I could get this instead. Just begin to think that. Think about how much better you'd feel, not how bad that whatever you're doing makes you feel. The focus forward. Here's what Paul said in Philippians 3:12. I don't mean to say that I've already achieved these things or that I've already reached perfection, but I press on to possess that perfection for which Christ Jesus first possessed me. Focus on the right goal, and God's going to move you forward. So here's a quick little thing, this acronym to help you set good goals. The business world talks about it. I'm out of the business world. We can learn some things from them, right? So y'all can write this down. Everybody ready? You need to set SMART goals. S, specific. Got to be able to be specific. Having more or less of something is not a goal or a good enough goal. Second, it should be measurable. Is there a finish line? Will you know when you cross the finish line? You know, whatever it is. Third, it's got to be attainable. Want to be a millionaire tomorrow? Well, good. It's really not a good goal tomorrow unless you're at $990,000. Right? So we've got to set something that's attainable. You know, some of you may walk out here and say, that's it. I'm going to spend an hour with Jesus every day for the rest of my life. Don't even go there. How about let's do 5 minutes if you've not been doing it regular. Let's do 5 minutes. Let's do that for between now and the end of October. Let's do 5 minutes. Then maybe we decide in November we're going to raise it to 10 minutes or whatever it is. Just something attainable. The fifth one is R, relevant. Set goals in areas that are going to help you move forward in your walk with God. Relevant to your spiritual life. You know who you are. And then the fifth is time bound. It's got to be a deadline on it. So by the end of October, I'm going to spend, whatever, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, every day, in the morning, first thing, with Jesus. That's relevant. That's smart. Amen? Just set one goal. By the way, some of us, you know, we set so many goals, we don't know which one we're on. Just set one. Start getting momentum in your life. Here's the fourth thing. Face and forsake your failures quickly. I got to move along here. I've told too many stories today. Face and forsake your failures quickly. No one's perfect. You're not going to be either. It's just not going to happen. Spiritual growth is not a string of continual successes. It's successes. It's failures. It's getting up. Just got to keep moving forward. And part of the secret of it to have a blessed and prosperous life is given in Proverbs 20:13, people who conceal their sins will not prosper, but if they confess and turn from them, they will receive mercy. You got to confess what you've been through, but you got to also move forward. So some of us are thinking, well, I've dealt with all the old stuff. Good. What'd you do about that fight on the way to church this morning? What'd you do about the one you had yesterday? It's a new day. It's in my past. No, maybe it's time to just say, hey, I need to get that right. I need to apologize to someone. I need to ask God's forgiveness, right? That's the key. The key is to deal with things quickly. Quickly. Don't wait till tomorrow. It's not a good time. There's actually a verse that says now is the acceptable time in the Bible. So one of the ways to forsake and face your failures and to overcome them quickly is just to have a time of personal self-examination every day. And the way that can look is the morning you spend time with Jesus, and in the evening, the last thing you do, and Kim and I do this, the last thing before we go to bed, we just kind of make sure we've cleaned up the whole day. We don't drag all that stuff into the next day. Pray over Kim. I ask God to forgive her of all her sins. But now I try to be a good husband, so I say our. But you know, it's just good to have that time at the end of the day. Amen. 1 Corinthians 11:31 says, but if we would examine ourselves, we would not be judged by God in this way. We've got to examine ourselves. And don't beat yourself up. Just get forgiveness. 1 John 1:9 says, but if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness and from all wickedness. Here's the fifth part of a life of spiritual growth. Number five, flee temptation, don't fear it. Flee it, don't fear it. Don't get hung up on thinking that if you really had victory over a hurt, habit, or hang up, you'd never be tempted in that area again. You will be. It's not a sin to be tempted. Let me say that again. It's not a sin to be tempted. Jesus was tempted. Hebrews 4:15 says, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. So, let me just say it this way. When God gives you an idea, it's divine inspiration. When the devil gives you an idea, it's temptation. But God doesn't leave you to deal with that all on your own. You just got to know that temptation from the enemy, that's just his invitation for you to sin. I love what Martin Luther said this, like 1500s, okay? He says, you can't keep the birds from flying over your head, but you can keep them from building a nest in your hair. Same thing with temptation. It's going to come. You're going to have thoughts. You're like, well, where did that crazy thought come from? Is it me? No, it's just the enemy tempting you. So there's two types of temptations we need to avoid. Tempting situations. Some of you just need to stay out of some circumstances because you get in trouble. And then tempting associations. There's some people that will drag you down. 1 Corinthians 15:33. Bad company corrupts good character. By the way, you won't get stung if you stay away from the bees. Just got to remember that. Now, I don't have time to go through it. There's some areas. One of the big ones that we've got in our culture today, avoid sexual sin. Just to clarify, sexual sin is any sex outside of marriage between a man and a woman who are married to each other. Anything outside of that is sexual sin. 1 Corinthians 6:18 says, run from sexual sin. No other sin so clearly affects the body as this one does, for sexual immorality is a sin against your own body. Another sin that's very common is the love of money. Living for money. 1 Timothy 6:9 says, but people who long to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many foolish and harmful desires that plunge them into ruin and destruction. For the love of money, not money, the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. And some people craving money have wandered from the true faith and pierced themselves with many sorrows. Real quickly, you know the cure for love of money? Giving to God through your local church. Just start someplace. You say, I can't tithe. Start someplace. Just start. You got money coming in? Start. It'll help you. Here's number six. participate in a small group and get on a dream team. Amen? You can still join a group. You can go through Growth Track where we help you understand teams. As a matter of fact, 3 o'clock this afternoon, online. If you're interested in Growth Track, write GT on your connection card, or you can put it on your online connection card, and we'll get you set up. Now, here's 2 reasons for you to be in a small group. And I know I'm going a little over today, but how many of you know you can handle it? Yes. 2 big reasons to have a group, have a team. 1, prayer. Prayer. 2 Corinthians 1 says, and he did rescue us from mortal danger, and he will rescue us again. In other words, you're going to have stuff happen in your life. Over and over, there's things that are happening. We have placed our confidence in him, and he will continue to rescue us. And look at this. And you are helping us by praying for us. That's amen. You guys are doing that. And in college, I had a college roommate who was going through a hard time. And we were sitting out on the steps of the dorm talking, and I was trying to encourage. You ever had those conversations? You're trying to encourage somebody that's not going so well? And finally, I just said to him, I said, well, you know, people are praying for you. You know what he did? He looked at me and said, who? Well, I knew my grandmother prayed for me. So I could say, you know, I knew grandma was praying. But I didn't know what his situation is. And I found that most people don't really have people praying for them, but you can get that in a small group. They'll be praying for you, not just when you meet, but during the week. Here's the second reason you need a small group: encouragement. Hebrews 10:25 says, and let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near. It's closer than it was yesterday. Oh, Pastor, when is it? It's closer than it was yesterday. He's coming back. Let's be encouraging. Amen? And finally, 7, because we've got to have the number of completion, right? Just for today. Finish like Jesus. Finish like Jesus. Aren't you glad God's not done with you? Aren't you glad he's still working in your life? Aren't you glad? So he says this in Philippians, God says this in Philippians 1:6. And I am certain that God, who began the good work within you, will continue his work until it is finally finished on the day when Christ Jesus returns. We're not going to be perfect before then. This is the rest of your life journey. What I gave you today is the rest of your life growth journey. Amen. The more you lean into it, the more you'll grow. Right? I know some of you were a little sarcastic. You're thinking, well, if I don't grow, then maybe, since it's going to be until the day of Jesus Christ returns, maybe he'll come later for me. No, I want to be on the first train. Amen? I want to be ready when he says my time is up. And so let's just keep leaning into it. Amen? So again, here's the growth choice in our next step today. I reserve a daily time with God. Reserve it. A daily time with God for Bible reading, self-examination, and prayer in order to know God and his will for my life and to gain the power to follow his will. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, we come to you today, and I thank you for each person. I thank you that we're deciding. Lord, I just sense here today that there's a lot of decisions being made to keep growing, to not stop, to keep moving forward. And so, Father, we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, give each person the strength they need, what they need. Lord, that time with you every day to move forward. We thank you in Jesus' name. With every head bowed, every eye closed, you online, just tuning, just staying focused with us here for a few more minutes. I want to ask this question. Are you right with God? Didn't ask if you're a good person. Didn't ask if you mean well. Didn't ask if you've got a good heart. Ask, are you right with God? Because the only way that you can be right with God is by putting your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, asking him to forgive your sins, surrendering your life to him, valuing what Jesus did on the cross for you. And if you've not made that decision, it's the greatest day to make it for you. Why wait another day? I want to invite you to pray a prayer with those of us that have already made that decision. But as you say this with us and you say it from your heart, here's what I know: God's going to do a work in your life. And so let's say this together from your heart. I know God's going to be working as you pray. Say this with me. Heavenly Father, I come to you today. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I ask you to make me a new person from the inside out. God, I turn away from my old life and I turn to you. God, I believe you raised Jesus from the dead. And Jesus, I ask you, be my Lord. Lead my life. I surrender to you today. In Jesus' name, amen.